Let it.
Let it resound.
Let it resound.
Loud as the rolling sea.
I like this part right here. Come on.
Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the
Luke's Gospel, chapter 4. beginning at verse 16. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." God's word for the people of God, all praises be to God.
Thank you.
Thank you to our praise team. Praise the Lord. Thank you to the clergy. I want us to think upon the subject. When he came to Nazareth. When he came to Nazareth. When Jesus came to Nazareth. Consecrate me to thy service, Lord, by thy power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. O God, as I stand behind this, your sacred desk, allow my presence to diminish until there's none of me but all of thee. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and my Savior, let the church say amen. Amen. When Jesus came to Nazareth, Virginia Union School of Theology offered a course for all first-year students. Back in the day, it was called the Urban Plunge. The course was held during the winter session. And the idea was to take idealistic students studying for ministry, drop them into a cold, wintry, harsh urban environment, places like Philadelphia or DC or Detroit or Chicago, but with about $1 a day for 3 days. The instructor gave you a telephone number for emergencies, and that was all. This was before pagers and cell phones and social media. You were left on a corner in the hood. No plush or comfortable hotel rooms. You slept on the streets or on the floor in a shelter. You were left to experience a measure of the vulnerabilities that accompany life on the streets. The whole point of the exercise was to open one's eyes and offer some sensitivity to ministry that cannot be gained in a classroom lecture or read in a book. I mean, you were baptized, Deacon Christian, into a new world. In a very real sense, we witness Jesus doing the same thing with the gospel in Luke's gospel. So come with me into the world of this biblical passage. Again, we catch up with Jesus at the dawn of his ministry. We know that Jesus begins his ministry at the age of 30. In our world today, that would make Jesus a millennial. Huh? It would be a millennial. He would be part of the generation that's very comfortable with mobile devices and would have several social media accounts. He is just getting started. He's completed his testing time in the wilderness. He met the challenges and obstacles that came his way from the devil. You recall, for every challenge the devil threw at Jesus, he defended himself and responded with the word of God. The devil twisted and distorted scripture to meet his own devilish ways. But, of course, Jesus rightly divides God's holy word. And by the way, let me add parenthetically, we need to know God's word for ourselves. History has shown us how slaveholders justified slavery with Bible verses, talking about the so-called curse of Ham. The KKK staged parades with banners saying, one God, one country, one flag. And for some folk, patriotism is their religious expression. During Virginia's massive resistance, we saw segregated Christian schools thrive under the guise of religious freedom. We need to know God and his word for ourselves. This year, as we move through the theme of better, we're talking about a better understanding of God's word and a better relationship with God. Jesus was able to withstand the wiles of the devil, and now Jesus is returning home to Nazareth. where he had been brought up. And this becomes our first move for consideration, Sister Emily Ladd. This becomes the first move when he came to Nazareth. This gospel, this Jesus Christ that we preach and teach, is undeniably the same yesterday, today, and forever. However, we've got to realize that the sameness is what speaks to the gospel's dynamic relevancy. And the reason for its relevance is that it meets us in the moment we find ourselves in. In other words, it is not outdated and fuddy-duddy. It hits today, it just hits in a new way for a new day. Look at the call of Isaiah. When he saw a vision of God in the temple, he tells us in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty with the hem of his robe. It filled the temple, and seraphs were in attendance above him, and each had six wings. And with two, they covered their faces. And with two, they covered their feet. And with two, they flew. And one called to another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called. And the house filled up with smoke. And I said, woe is me. I'm lost. I'm a man of unclean lips. And I live among a people of unclean lips. And yet, my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And then, he says, I heard a voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here am I, Lord. Send me. The historian, physician Luke, goes to great lengths to ensure in his orderly account that we understand that whatever he shares is not occurring in a vacuum. In other words, God's word, which is eternal, is the same at the same time anchored in time. That's why he tells us, in the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah. That's why he tells us in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth. That's why he tells us in those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. That's why he tells us in those days a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all in the world should be registered. That's why he tells us in that region there were shepherds living in the fields keeping watch over the flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them. The gospel has got to hit in a way that is relevant and meaningful for such a time as this. One of the paradoxes of this time, this gospel that we preach, is that it is shared in real time. An explicit era, a particular period, an exact millennia, a concrete century, a defined decade, a distinct year, a well-defined month, a fixed week, a definite day, a recognizable hour, a noticeable minute, a specific second, a marked millisecond, an unmistakable moment. That's why we sing, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. How many of us know he's an all-time God? See, Jesus is the Word, and the Word became flesh. And Jesus will show up at the right time in your life. Do I have a witness in the house today? Is there anybody who can testify that God showed up in your life in the nick of time, in the 11th hour, he showed up? Willie May, do I have a witness this morning that he showed up in the second move? Jesus not only shows up when you need him, but beloved, he'll show up where you need him. That's the second move. He'll show up where you need him. In this passage, we see Jesus shows up where he had been brought up. He shows up in Nazareth. And I would submit that he will show up in your Nazareth. Wherever that Nazareth is, he'll show up where you are. And he will change the trajectory of where you thought you were going. He does this when he calls his first disciples. Jesus was beside the lake of Gennesaret when he met up with Simon, Peter, James, and John. You know, they were fishermen. They dropped their nets and picked up the gospel plow. They went from catching fish to catching people. Jesus met them where they were. Look at the late Congressman John Lewis. Lewis was called the conscience of Congress. He was given a Bible at the age of 4 and was drawn into the world of Christian faith and the church and ministry. He famously started preaching to the chickens on his family's farm. His first act of nonviolent protest was when his parents would kill one of the chickens and Lewis would refuse to eat the chicken. He was a congressman, but he was a Christian first. Lewis used to tell the story of how he heard God speaking to him one night through a radio broadcast. Lewis's faith was fueled as a teenager while he was listening to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. on the radio. Lewis was immediately captivated by King and transformed by his social justice gospel. He said it was as though a light had turned on in his heart. He felt God directly talking to him. Lewis was just a teenager when he preached his initial sermon. You look at the late Reverend E.V. Hill. He used to tell the story of how at the age of 11, the Holy Spirit came upon him while he was walking down the street. He was going to his grandma Jody's house. The Lord called me to Christian discipleship one Sunday morning at Second Baptist Church in Rosella. Shout out to Second Baptist. Years later, he would speak to my heart and call me to Christian ministry when I was ripping and running in New York City, working in broadcast news. The Lord will meet you where you are. Jesus was walking along. He saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth. He said, "Matthew, come on, follow me." Got up, followed him. There he sat at a dinner in the house with tax collectors and sinners, all sitting around him with his disciples. The Pharisees saw this. They said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick." He said, "I've come to call not the righteous, but sinners." See, Jesus comes on the scene, and he will show up where there is a need. In the third move, what is before us? In other words, what do we see when we look at Jesus in the synagogue? I mean, do you see this now? Jesus has come home now. He's in the synagogue. He stands up. The pulpit associate hands him the parchment of scripture. He enrolls the scroll, opens up the manuscript to the prophet Isaiah. You might recall that Isaiah, he is the mouthpiece of God. He's the one who said, "For a child has been born for us, a son given to us, authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. This is the prophet who declared, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that was made whole, and by his bruises we're healed. This is the prophet who declared, seek the Lord while he might be found, and call upon him while he is near. This is the prophet Isaiah who declared he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. This is Isaiah. The Lord addresses the role and person of the Messiah. And here, Jesus, the homeboy, who has come back to the hood, is laying claim to his messiahship. Can I teach it for a moment? He moved through all of the classical stages of a call experience. From early religious exposure, remember he was presented as a baby at the temple, to a time of struggle or searching. At the age of 12, he was in the temple among the teachers and then searching, and eventually led him out into the wilderness, discerning God's will for his life. And then ultimately, there's a time of surrender where he's victorious over the devil, and now returning home filled with the Holy Spirit. We're not privy to Jesus' internal feelings or restlessness, but we see here that he is not caught in a quandary. He is not betwixt and between a thousand times, no. Because he stands up and he boldly declares, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news. The gospel that meets people where they are makes a difference in their lives. God took a little baby born in 1851 in Buckingham County, Virginia. William and Delphia's little baby boy. He worked in tobacco factories and rock quarries, and when he was a teenager, a young adult, Richard Spiller accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. Deacon Joy, this turned his whole life around, sent him on a different trajectory. He felt a heavenly calling, heard about a school in Richmond that could equip him to serve God and God's people. That school was Culver Institute, and today is Virginia Union. Richard Spiller and a small group of free and formerly enslaved black folk would go on to organize Queen Street Baptist Church in 1884, and actually built the first structure within 6 weeks. Don't tell me what we cannot do when we put our hearts and minds to it. The Lord changed Spiller's life, and that change that day impacts us this day. This is what the gospel does. This is what the gospel is. God wrapped in flesh and living among us. He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Today, Jesus is fulfilling the scripture in your hearing. Today is a day of new beginnings. Today is the day to love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, and bless who curse you and pray for those who mistreat you. Today is the day when that which others meant for evil, God will use for good. Today is that day when we can commit our way to the Lord. Today is the day when the kingdom of God is no longer somewhere out there, but is manifested and made real right here. Today is the day when the Lord will redeem you. The Lord will empower you. The Lord will liberate you. Today is the day when problems will be solved and prayers will be answered and doors will be opened and burdens will be lifted. Today, Jesus has come to Nazareth. Amen. Let's stand. We want to extend the invitation. Perhaps today is the day that Jesus has stepped into your Nazareth. Today is the day, if you don't know the Lord, today is the day that you can accept him as your Lord and Savior. Today is the day, now is the moment to give your life to the Lord. So we want to extend the invitation. Is there one? Is there one? God bless you. Have a wonderful day in the Lord. We thank you for being with us and working.